Dr. Rizzitano, what are the treatments currently available for PNH?
PNH is not just one disease. Actually, the disease presentation can be heterogeneous. So we have two different kinds of treatment. The first one is for patients with hemolysis and thrombosis, and we use different kinds of anti-complement agents. Basically, historically speaking, we have the anti-C5 agent, eculizumab, and now in some countries, including U.S., we have a new anti-complement agent, another anti-C5, which is named ravulizumab. On top of them, more recently, we also have a different class of agents targeting the other proteins of the complement cascade, and in particular, C3. We have an anti-C3 treatment, which is named pegcetacoplan. They are all targeting the complement system and are very effective treatment for hemolysis and thrombosis, hopefully, but they cannot cure the disease. Just for curing the disease, we have to think about that the other possible manifestation of PNH is bone marrow failure, and in this case, we have to give the treatment that we have to use to give in patients with aplastic anemia. So we use immunosuppression or bone marrow transplantation. Bone marrow transplantation for PNH patients may result in the cure, but at least right now, it is reserved only to patients with specific clinical presentation, namely aplastic anemia, bone marrow failure. So once again, just to make it easy for everybody, if we want to target bone marrow failure in PNH, we have to give immunosuppression or transplantation, and this is the standard treatment for aplastic anemia. In most cases, when we speak about PNH, we allude to hemolysis and thrombotic risk, and here the treatment is based on anti-complement agents, and we are transitioning from anti-C5 treatment, eculizumab and ravulizumab, to proximal inhibitors, which are becoming available in the last few months, and they may be effective mostly in patients with poor response to the standard anti-complement treatment.
Are there new therapies being studied that may help PNH patients in the future?
Yes, we have many new treatments. Actually, I was already alluding to the proximal inhibitors, which are in development for targeting patients who are not responding very well to the standard anti-C5 treatment. Anti-C3 with pegcetacoplan is one of these options. This is a drug which is given subcutaneously with the pump, given, let's say, twice a week, twice or thrice a week, and apparently it may improve the efficacy in patients who are not responding very well to both eculizumab and ravulizumab. In addition to anti-C3, we also have drugs targeting factor D and factor B, which are two other proteins of the complement cascade. And here I would start saying that these compounds are quite different because they are orally available. So basically, we move from IV to sub-Q to tablets. This is very convenient for patients. Of course, this is also dangerous in some way because if a patient forgets a tablet, this could result in clinical presentation. And these compounds are right now in clinical development. Preliminary results in phase two trials are very, very promising, and we are conducting worldwide many different phase three trials that hopefully will lead to the registration of these compounds. In addition to this, we also have other anti-C5 treatments, which in some way reproduce the safety and the efficacy of eculizumab. They are given either intravenously or subcutaneously. They could represent other options for PNH patients, but in my opinion, just speaking about class of agents, we should speak about anti-C5, which is the treatment that we have used so far, and we may improve not just in terms of efficacy, but in terms of convenience, moving from IV every other week to IV every other month or sub-Q every month. And there are other compounds which are in development with these features. And then the proximal inhibitors, which are targeting C3, factor B, and factor D, these compounds may really improve the efficacy of the current anti-C5 treatment. And at the moment, we are investigating whether they should be reserved to patients who are not responding very well to anti-C5, or if they can be used in all patients with PNH, because they may lead to better response, basically, in any patient with PNH.
Why is it important for PNH patients to enroll in the global PNH patient registry?
Well, PNH is a rare disease. The only way to improve our knowledge in the field is just to collect data. Any of you, any single patient is important, because we can describe individual presentation, which are always relevant. And, you know, all the drops together may make the sea. So if we will be able to put together all the data from different patients, from different countries, different ethnicity, we may collect information that may be effective for improving our knowledge and our treatment for the future. Maybe what it's very important to know for patients is that if today we are able to better treat PNH patient, is because in the past we are able to do such studies altogether. In most cases, they are driven by the scientific community. But of course, since things are changing, it's very important that patients are proactive in sharing their own information in this community, which is not including just physicians and scientists, but it must also include patients and their family. We are one all unique community.